Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies this morning. The first agenda item is to agree whether to take items 3 and 4 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence and a discussion about our work programme. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. The next agenda item The next agenda item is the next in a series of roundtables, and today we're looking at the misuse of drugs and the criminal justice system, and I refer members to papers 1 to 3. And I welcome our panel of witnesses this morning. We have Mr. Anthony McGeehan, Procurator Fiscal, Policy and Engagement, Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. Mr. Peter Krykant, activist and campaigner. Natalie Logan McLean, Chief Executive Officer, Sustainable Interventions, Supporting Change Outside. Superintendent Norman Conway of Police Scotland. Leanne Hughes, Shine Programme Mentor, and Louise Stevenson, Lived Experience Participant of SACRO. Neil Richardson, OBE, Vice Chair, and Becky Wood, Lived Living Experience Representative of the Scottish Drugs Deaths Task Force, and Mr. David Liddell, Chief Executive Officer of the Scottish Drugs Forum. And we appreciate the time that you've taken to join us this morning. I thank the witnesses for their written submissions. These are now available online, and I intend to allow around about 2 hours for discussion this morning. Please, can I ask members to indicate which witness you're directing your remarks to, and we can then open the floor to other witnesses for comments. If other witnesses wish to respond, can I ask you to indicate to me or the clerks that you want to come in, and I'll bring you in then if time permits. If you are merely agreeing with what the witness is saying, there's no need to intervene to say so. You can just let us know that you want to come in by typing an R in the chat thread. So we will now move directly to questions, and please can members and our invited guests keep questions and comments as succinct as possible. So I'd like to open up the discussion this morning with a fairly general question for Peter, Louise, Natalie, and then Becky. So perhaps if I start with Peter, I'd like to ask you to what extent you want to share with us. Can you tell us about your personal experience and how we deal with drugs misuse within the criminal justice system, and how that may have impacted on you personally, how accessible you have found support in order to give people a route to recovery from drug misuse and addiction in Scotland? So Peter, if you would like to start things off.
Yeah, thanks very much, and thanks for inviting me to give evidence. If I look back to my early drug use, facilitated involvement with the criminal justice system as early as the age of 16. I was in a young offenders institution, which is now closed, Longregend. And prior to going into Longregend, I wasn't a heroin user. More or less straight away, as soon as I got released from Longregend after spending 3 months in that institution, I became a heroin user. At that point, the offer and the support that was available in order to try and address some of the underlying things that were going on for me, some of the adverse childhood experiences and trauma that I'd suffered growing up, just wasn't available. And I suppose today, that's the frustrating thing, that still 25 years later, we still don't have that access to the support that we need to keep people from recycling through the criminal justice system for street level drug use, and people who are currently in the supply of drugs as well, who are simply supplying drugs in order to try and feed their own drug dependency issues. people just don't have the support, you know. And as I say, 25 years on, more than 25 years on since I was in that situation, a homeless public injecting drug user using drugs in alleyways and behind bins and prone to infection and disease, we are still in exactly the same position here in Scotland as we were all those years ago, when we have internationally recognised evidence-based ways to reduce the harm caused by drug use that we're simply not allowed to implement at this time, or we're not finding a way to do that when there is clear ways that we can implement evidence-based ways that can support people off illicit drugs and onto medication which keeps them well and allows them to be productive members of society.
Much, Peter. That's very helpful. I'll just maybe move on to Louise. Ask very much the same question, a little bit about your personal experience in relation to how we deal with drug misuse issues within the criminal justice system, how that's impacted on you personally, and any other comments that you have that would be helpful for us. So, Louise, over to you.
Hi, thanks for inviting me to this. Just as Peter says there, there's an echo in the room and it's putting me off. I'm all about safe consumption room. That is my goal, would be to get safe consumption rooms around everywhere, in my own area. I mean, we definitely need them. In other areas, Glasgow, the Central Belt, everywhere, we need them. So I definitely agree with Peter on that. The criminal justice here, they are quite good at helping, but that's if you tell them the truth. You have to tell them the truth for them to help you.
Thank you for that, Louise. I think we've managed to sort of sort out the echo on the line, so that's,
yeah.
That's very helpful. Thank you. Natalie, can I bring you in just with the same questions?
My experience with addiction was I was one of the children that was born into the heroin epidemic, and unfortunately, if you lived in a disadvantaged or deprived area, you were going to be one of the children that experienced the neglect of that generation of drugs. So unfortunately, although I did have a family that loved and cared for me, they were unfortunately unable to raise me because crime and drugs took prevalence over my education or nurturing me to become a strong, independent woman. Schooling was difficult for me because I did move from a chaotic area into quite an affluent area where I didn't fit in, and my family were still criminals, so I was trying to fit into a world where I really didn't belong, and I got a bit lost. Drugs were very accessible to me because I had family members that sold them. So having come from a very abusive background, my coping blanket became using drugs and substances. But unfortunately, when I did want to get help, there wasn't any help available back in 2006 or 2007, 8, 2009 for that matter. And what I've witnessed over the years is there's been an absolute decrease in the support available, and there is no longer any choice. And I think that's what we're lacking, is being able to offer same-day prescriptions, being able to have safe consumption vans in deprived areas, being able to access holistic methods of support, whether that be residential or day programmes. I was one of the fortunate ones that had a care manager that cared, actually. And that, for me, is missing in a lot of services, the care element. You know, we work in a system of care, and not all staff members care about your journey, nor do they care if you abstain from the drugs that's potentially killing you. But I could go on about my issues all day, and I think for the purpose of this today, it's about exploring the gaps, what's missing, and trying to pull the evidence together.
Thank you, Natalie. A few really important and interesting points covered there. Finally, Becky, can I come to you and just open the floor to you?
Hi there. Thank you for inviting me along this morning. So I think my experience is a little bit different from the experiences that have been described so far, but I think it's quite typical of women in Scotland. So I didn't come to use illegal drugs, although I believe I had an addiction and had an addictive personality and had issues with substances right up until I started using illegal drugs. I didn't come to that until later on in my life. I was in my 30s. And I believe that it was the culmination of things that contributed to making my life difficult over that period. So I was brought up in a small Scottish town. I was brought up in poverty. There was a lack of jobs available to people in the town that I lived. I'm quite old, so sort of the 80s. And I suffered trauma. I was in a violent relationship for quite a long time, for about 15 years, before I managed to get the strength to come out of that relationship. And by that time, I was traumatised and quite broken and desperate, and using drugs, to me at that point, seemed to be the answer to the pain going on in my head. And the experience that I had with criminal justice, it varied depending what was going on for me. I lived with a drug user. He was known by the police. He used and sold drugs. And I was often caught up in that situation, so were my children. The experience I had at that time depended on what the situation was and who it was that came to that situation. So I had some quite positive experiences with community police officers who were a bit more understanding of maybe the local circumstances and had a different job. You know, that wasn't their job to be deciding whether I was a drug user, drug dealer, or buying drugs illegally. You know, that wasn't their job. I think with drug enforcement officers, things obviously, their jobs are different. And it was less helpful to me as somebody who really had a health problem and needed help to be arrested, locked up. Thankfully, I didn't get a prison sentence, but I was arrested over and over again. Which takes me on maybe to my court experiences as well. So I feel really grateful that I lived in Clackmannanshire with a sheriff in Clackmannanshire called Sheriff Mackey. And his way of working with people who had drug problems was really helpful. And he gave people opportunities to do community service or be on a payback order, and supported people to get help for their addiction. So that was a good experience for me. I think that really gave me the feeling that I was being given a chance. And I think
Becky,
I was going to say that I sorry.
No, I was going to say you've made some really powerful points. So just so that I can give members the opportunity to maybe come in with some other questions for the
Thank
four
you.
Of you, Peter, Louise, Natalie, and yourself. I'll maybe just stop you there for the moment and just open up questions to any of the other members who maybe want to come in. Jamie Green.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our panel. Can I thank our first three speakers for sharing their own personal experiences. I know it's often difficult to speak about these in public, but we do value your lived experiences, so thank you. But I did want to ask, there seemed to be a common theme that came through the three answers, and that was that there always seemed to be a trigger, there always seemed to be a first time, if you like, where you maybe were either proactively trying drugs for the first time, or indeed may have been coerced or into it, or you felt pressurised in some way due to the peer network you were in. But can I ask, what do you think could have been done differently at that time in terms of early intervention so that that first time never led to the second or the third or the fourth and the addiction that it therefore created thereafter? What do you think could have been done at that point to stop that spiral from even starting in the first place? And that's open to anyone. You can just wave your hand if you want to answer. Thank you.
Peter, would you like to come in on that? I think you were wanting to come in anyway.
Louise.
Yeah, happy to come in. Thanks, Jamie, for the question. And, you know, I don't think for me there was a particular, like, one incident in my life that sparked, you know, problematic substance use. You know, like, the where I grew up, a small village on the outskirts of Falkirk, you know, a lot of my peer group were experimenting with substances like cannabis and alcohol, you know, poppers and LSD and amphetamines and ecstasy. And I've got to say that I had some of the best times of my life on drugs. You know, the issue is not drugs here. You know, the issue is how we police drugs. The issue is an unregulated market that leads to so many people dying. You know, the fact that you yourself can walk into any safe consumption facility in the UK and order half a pint of lager or a vodka, and you know that that's not going to kill you. You can wake up every morning and put caffeine in your body. But if you go and get a substance which is controlled by a criminal gang and you have no idea what's in it, you are dicing with death every time you use it. And that's where our real issues lie. In terms of that being catapulted into problematic substance use, that was actually, a lot of that was how we are currently policing things. You know, I was arrested for a small possession charge at a very young age of cannabis, which catapulted me into the criminal justice system, which didn't help in any way, shape or form with what led to real problematic substance use for me. You know, so it's not about the substances, it's about how we regulate substances. If we had a regulated market, so many people would not be dying right now. People are dying because of criminal gangs controlling the market. It's that simple.
Thanks, Peter. I think the issue of organised crime and their place will come up later, and also the issue of people accessing drugs for the first time whilst in detention, either young offenders or adult prisoners. But I think those are issues that may come up later. I think Louise wanted to talk to me a little bit about that as well.
Yeah, I did. Thanks. Well, for me, it wasn't just one thing, like Peter said, that made him, it turned him into drugs. It was many things going on in my life. This where I lived, other people like you say, peers, and also people who you would trust, that you think you would be able to trust, actually, giving you drugs at a young age. I mean, I stuck in it at school. I was in like 6 years. I'd done hires. So for me, it's no whether you've got the biggest brain in the world, you're a clever, you're intelligent. My younger sister, for instance, she's got no experience for school because she left in third year due to bullying, but she's now working as a nurse with old people with dementia. So I see that as you didn't have to just stick in at school to be, oh, get a job, get this, get that. I've been in prison and I want to now better my life. And I hope that this actually gives me an opportunity to do that. I've never done anything like this in my life before, but I do like talking. So I like doing that, eh? But I do believe, I do agree with Peter, safe consumption, rooms, vans, ambulances, whatever you want to call it. I think that is what we need in this country, because who wants to walk past trees and see needles sticking out of a tree? Who wants to go and see somebody lying next to a bush overdosed? Nobody wants to see that. So for me, if we've got safe consumption rooms all around, every, like maybe one in Kirkcaldy, one Glenrothes, Amphifife, by the way, so this is why I'm saying these towns, at least there's one, and then let it grow. Because, like I say, you didn't want to see people lying there dead, and, oh, we could have saved that person with naloxone. But we never, because, oh, we haven't got naloxone, and, oh, there isn't any safe consumption rooms. I mean, I see people all the time. Closies, no, even in the close, they're standing at the doorway at the close so they can get some light. It's crazy. And most of the drugs in my area is crack. The crack is an epidemic in my town and all around, like the central belt of Fife over at Stirling, Glasgow, Edinburgh, I'm sure, maybe Dundee as well. But it's more nowadays crack than heroin or your benzodiazepines. And I mean, I'm not saying that's not still going on, because it is, but it's crack. Cocaine is the worst drug, and I've lived it myself. I've been there. I've been in prison. I've been in prison for robbing shops or to get crack, which I wouldn't have done for heroin. Things that people are doing things nowadays for crack that they would never have dreamed of doing for heroin, and that's what we need to change.
Thank you, Louise. I know that that's very powerful, and we like you talking. It's very helpful. Can I maybe bring in Natalie? I think you were quite keen to come in, and then I think we'll move things on a wee bit. Natalie.
Yeah, for me, I think when I was younger, we had a lot of these campaigns, and it was the Just Say No campaigns, and I think probably for everyone round the table, if you tell a child, don't do something, curiosity will absolutely want us to do something. So campaigns like that absolutely didn't help. And what they done was they created a lot more stigma than they probably anticipated they were going to. But I think we continue to get lost. People are already lost. Drugs are absolutely a symptom. They're not the cause. You know, people are... When we look at addiction, most people addicted to substances come from deprivation. So we know within those deprived areas and communities that, you know, trauma is prevalent, abuse, neglect, sexual, physical. You know, we know that literacy and numeracy within the schools are not being met. So I think that if we continue to look at addiction symptom and not looking at, you know, the cause, what is the environment of the child, how are they being raised, is removing them for the parent going to be helpful? Because in my experience of my own addiction, the system created the failure within me by removing me from my mother. My mother was never unfit to look after me, nor was she a drug addict. My father was a drug addict, but the system removed me from my mother and my sister and put me to live with my grandparents. And they were the ones that created the trauma in my father to begin with, you know. So we have generations of systematic failures where we continue to look at drugs being the problem. Drugs are just the symptom. We need to look at the cause. What is the cause of individuals using these to begin with?
Thank you, Natalie. I know a number of members would like to come in with some final questions. So I'd like to bring in Rona Mackay and then Fulton McGregor.
I'd like to ask Natalie, the first time you spoke, you alluded to a gap in services and you know, that should be there. I wonder if you want to expand a wee bit on that and your thoughts on that.
In gaps in service provision?
Mm-hmm. You spoke I about, think, yeah, you, that's, I think that those were the words you used, that there were gaps. So just maybe expand a wee bit.
I think for me I can give you my personal experience and my experience today as a professional. So my personal experience is when I went to seek help, no one knew what to do with me because I lived in Bishopbriggs, which was quite an advantaged area. I had a relatively good job at the time. I had children that schooled in Bishopbriggs. So when I went to the GP to say, you know, I can't live my life like this anymore, my GP didn't know what to do with me. And then he was saying, you know, we can refer you into the community addiction team, but I don't know if that would be okay for you. So like my GP was stigmatising what a community addiction team would be or who fits into the criteria going there. Then when I went to the community addiction team, I was dealt with social work department, then removed my children because I admitted that I had a problem. So for me, the gaps there was no one was nurturing me to say, like, you know, this is how to be a better mother, or this is how to keep your children, or this is what we're going to do to support you. And again, my choice of drug was not heroin or at that time injecting needles into my body. It was alcohol and cocaine. And I guess in society, we accept that a little bit more than that we do with harder drugs. So it was maybe seen as a superficial addiction. So the community addiction team, they didn't know what to do with me because they couldn't put me on methadone. It wasn't an opiate-related addiction. I was passed to 4 different addiction workers. That was in a 2-year period where I got progressively worse and deteriorated, because going to environments like community addiction teams, you start to meet people that you wouldn't typically meet in my life anyway. So I was then exposed to new drug types, and it was my 4th addiction worker that recognised, actually, you know, you shouldn't have been here all that time. Let's look at getting you into rehab. And that was the Willy Wonka golden ticket for me, Rona, I have to be honest. Few and far between, back in 2011, got the opportunity of residential rehab, but, you know, she recognised that I wasn't, in fact, a terrible mother. I wasn't, in fact, a bad person. I was a professional person that just got lost. So I fortunately got into rehab, and as soon as I was released from rehab, I got into a community day programme that they ceased to be around anymore because we closed all community day programmes. That's my experience, Shona. My professional experience is that there is very little service provision. So the gaps for me is we work within the Scottish Prison Service, and we can do fantastic work with men in the prison service. We know that 47% of men and women in prison go under the age of 11 with numeracy and literacy. So we know that if we develop them skills, support, CV build, we look at their well-being, we look at what their family support network is when they leave, we can build a really good care plan from the prison. However, it's the gaps when they leave. They are liberated to no GP. Their benefits are not secured. They have to present a homeless casework team to find out what accommodation they're going to have on that day. So that there is no sustainable plan for individuals in that element. And even every single day, I'll have a family member or a chaotic drug user phoning me saying, can you help me? What support is available in my area? How can I engage in your service? There's no fluency. And the reason for that, Rona, is because we have very little choice in Scotland. What we've done for the past 20 years is invest into a medical model, which is great. Medicine helps, but where is the holistic rehabilitation to support the medical model?
Thanks, Natalie. I think that was a really, really important contribution and you know, really informative. And if I could say, I think your story has been quite inspirational, the way you've turned your life around. But what you've told us there is really so useful with your experience of you know, what you've been through in the system. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in, just before I go to you, Fulton, I'm just going to bring in Becky. I think you would like to make a couple of points, if they can be fairly brief. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I'll try and be brief. It's not one of my strong points, sorry. So I just wanted to pick up on the point about it's a very complex problem, this, isn't it? And I think there's a range of options that need to be put in place to support people before they enter the drug scene, and those supports for people that have ended up in the criminal justice system. And I completely agreed with everything that Natalie said about a holistic approach. There are some good projects going on around the country with children about... there's one at a primary school in Alloa, where they just create an environment of safety, a feeling of being able to talk openly and support each other. And I think, although that might sound really detached from what we're talking about today, that the long-term solution to this is about making our children's homes a safer place, letting children know what's acceptable and what's not acceptable in their lives, and giving them opportunities to get support and to be able to talk if they're having difficulties.
Thank you, Becky. I'll bring in Fulton now, and then I'll bring you in, Louise. I know that you're keen to come in, but I'll bring in Fulton McGregor first.
Yeah, thanks, convener. And it's a broad question to the four people who have spoken to us about the lived experience, which I really, really appreciate, and I think is very helpful for the committee. And I just want to say, before starting my question, I also I'm a big believer in safe consumption rooms, and I do think that, we need to find a way to make this happen. But my question's about, we're obviously the Criminal Justice Committee, my question is about, and you've all touched on it already, but the interaction with the various justice services that this committee has a remit for, and we'll hear from many of them later today, and how trauma-informed do you think that is when these services are interacting with people who are using drugs, whether that's criminal justice social work, whether that's the police, whether that's the courts and prosecution services, etc., etc. How trauma informed do you think that is? Is there a stigma within the agencies and within the organisations about drug users? Natalie, I think you touched on that a wee bit there. And how can we get better with that? And the convener, I realise that's quite a general question as well, so I'm happy for you to pick out who you think.
I'll maybe bring Louise. I know that you were keen to come in. I wonder if you might like to respond to that, and then maybe go back to the point that you were keen to make earlier.
I'm really sorry. I was just focused on what I was going to say, so I'm not 100% what Guy has just said there. My point was off the back of Natalie. I mean, my son was removed from me when he was 10 days old. I never got the chance to bring him up. I never got no opportunities. I think my life, well, I know my life would be different, completely different, had I been given the chance to bring my son up. But because I had no family support, I wasn't using drugs at the time. I was using drugs when I found out I was pregnant. They put me on 30 mils of methadone. That was enough for me. Then they actually put me up an extra 10 mils. Although I said 30 mil was enough, I was being sick with it. Because it was on the prescription and my addictions worker was on holiday, they couldn't take it away, which is beyond me. They could have gave me a new prescription for somebody else. But they put me up to 40 mils when I was pregnant. I was being sick every day, and then the morning the sickness started. But my point is, I didn't get a chance to bring him up, and I know that would have made my life different, because when I gave birth to my son 2013, I then started getting the jail in 2014. I never got the jail before that. I'd had my son, like I say, August 2013, got to jail May 2014, and it's been a revolving door. And I've been out for 6 months now, and I've done great. So I'm happy to be doing this today, and I'm actually quite excited about it.
Louise, just a huge well done. You're a powerful witness. And thank you for that. I'm going to just bring in Peter. Perhaps you would like to make a few comments in response to Fulton's question. Peter.
Yeah, thanks very much, and thanks, Fulton. I think you know, the support for overdose prevention sites in Scotland is well appreciated. Having ran the unsanctioned one in Glasgow, I had a lot of frontline interaction with Police Scotland, and I've got to say that it was one of the highlights of running that service was the interaction with Police Scotland. Frontline officers, in my experience now, in comparison to my experience being in the system and part of the system 25 years ago, is completely different. I do think officers are a lot more aware of trauma. They're a lot more trauma informed now. They do want the ability to divert people away from the criminal justice system and into the treatment services that people so desperately need, rather than, you know, going through the court system. I think we have a lot more solicitors now who are trauma informed. We have sheriffs who are aware of the situation, but sometimes when it gets to court, if somebody is charged even with a simple possession of a Class A substance and it gets to court, sheriffs are often, their hands are tied, so they have no other option than to divert them into the criminal justice system or sentence them into the criminal justice system, especially if they have a history, prior history of being in and out the justice system already. And that's why the evidence that I submitted on behalf of the organisation that I work for now, Cranston, I think is really important in terms of how a diverse system works. You know, often you maybe get, you know, people getting caught with small amounts of cocaine who are out at a nightclub or a little bit of MDMA. They turn up in the court system on a Monday morning. The sheriff then needs to divert them into a treatment service. They don't need to be there. Treatment services are already under the cosh with the amount of the caseloads that they have. So if we can divert those people from prosecution at the beginning into an education programme, keep them out of the criminal justice system, because let's get it right, how many high-ranking politicians have admitted to small amounts of substance use in the past? You know, they certainly wouldn't need to be diverted into the treatment services. They could be kept out of that, therefore keeping our already treatment services who need to deal with problematic substance users free to do so. So, yeah, in terms of trauma, I think we're a lot more aware of it. There's a lot better practice, but our hands are still tied with the 50 years old Misuse of Drugs Act, one of the longest running pieces of legislation that's had no reform. Outdated, it's not fit for purpose. Drugs are different now, they're consumed in a different way, and we need to push the UK government to deal with that act of law, so that we can have better practice here in Scotland.
Thank you, Peter. Back to you, Fulton.
Yep, that's fine, Kavira, thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. I know that I think Becky and Louise are keen to come back in. I'd like to just bring in Colette Stevenson, just so that members have all got an opportunity to ask some questions. So, Colette Stevenson.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And thanks very much. Some of the evidence that you've produced so far has been so powerful, and I take my hat off to each of you. So thank you. I wanted to look at more. We talk about person-centred approach throughout, you know, your recovery when you're going through it. And from my own experience as a family member, I wanted to ask you more about this, about it was almost like the guilt and the stigma as well, going through all of that. But again, as a family member who's experienced something similar to what you spoke about, was the advice that you got was, you know, you're only feeding their habit, you know, you need to wait till they've hit rock bottom. And when I reflect on that now, and I see some of the things that some of the places like the Beacons are doing in South Lanarkshire, it was the totally wrong advice. So can I just ask, have you seen a shift change in terms of that approach and getting that person-centred support in place, and as well as that, your family? Because arguably most families are pretty scared when it comes to stuff like this as well. So I'd be keen to know if you've seen a change.
I'll maybe bring in Becky, followed by Louise, perhaps, to pick up those points. Becky first.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I have experience as a family member as well. I think probably because addiction is a family disease. So I totally understand the difficulties for family members. And I think there is progress that's been made. My experience of that is within, I work for a recovery community in North Lanarkshire. And we also are attached to a recovery community in Fife Valley as well. And we have a whole family approach in supporting people into recovery. And it's that is the answer to this. But we're a small charity. We don't have a lot of pool, maybe with other organisations. And my experience of family members receiving the guidance and support that they need, in my experience, hasn't really changed much. And I have a friend whose son recently overdosed. Was repeatedly overdosing, and was, first of all, he was overdosing on one occasion. His dad managed to resuscitate him, so the ambulance didn't arrive to take him to hospital on that occasion. They said if he was revived, then he would be okay, which I think is, you know, should never happen. It wouldn't have happened if he'd been having a stroke and then felt better. And secondly, when he did access the service, eventually was told that his addiction wasn't severe enough to need treatment. The family weren't given information, they weren't supported, they weren't given any explanation of why their son didn't appear to fit into the service. So I think there's a lot of work still to be done there. But engagement with a recovery community is definitely the way forwards. We have community members who are family members. They have lived experience as I do. You know, so I think it's really important to involve the whole family and get that holistic approach.
Thank you, Becky. Louise, would you like to come in?
Pretty much what Peter has said is That's pretty much what I was going to say. Apart from police officers in my area, they don't seem to have enough training, if you like, to work with people with mental health. Or they don't have any empathy. They just take you and that's you. And I don't think that's fair. I don't think it's right. They need the training to then deter whether you should be in that cell or whether you should be in the hospital. Do you know what I mean? And again, what was it, Becky? We do get treated like second class citizens. I've been in hospital and I've had blood taking and they never noticed my needle marks at the time. And this, I'm talking like 8, 9, 10 years ago. But as soon as they noticed the marks on my arms, that was it. They did not care. They treated me like a second class citizen. And I don't think that's not their, they've got a duty of care regardless to what you do or if you take drugs, if you don't take drugs, if you, whatever. They have that duty of care, but some of them don't.
Thank you, Louise. I'll hand back to Colette Stevenson. I know that Natalie and Peter want to come in after.
It was really, again, you know, and I think we actually had a debate in chamber yesterday, and it was more like the stigma and how we actually, you know, tackle the stigma. And again, I would like to, you know, hear your comments on and how we tackle that stigma as well, using words like junkie, even that, you know, having gone through the criminal justice system, the impact that has. And the stigma there as well, and just how we move away from that.
Natalie, would you like to come in, followed by Peter? And if you can make your comments fairly brief.
I think for me, we get very comfortable with using very tokenistic words like person-centred, and I hear service providers say to family members, you know, don't worry about it, we're going to use a very person-centred approach, and we're going to make sure everything's okay. And it's a great word and it sounds very, very fancy, but what does that mean to the individual? Because person-centred for me is answering the phone to someone at 11 o'clock at night or 12 o'clock at night, or knowing that my background issues might be different from you, Colette. So that to me is person-centred. And I think my first drug death was in 1986, and I've had 6 family members pass away since then, and it hasn't gotten any better. I think that society is all responsible now, and I think the media play a massive part in the language that they use, that lots of the stigma comes from the media and the language that they're using and how they portray individuals that have addiction issues. And I think if we start to look at addiction as a health inequality, then maybe that will maybe just reduce the stigma that's attached to it.
Thank you, Natalie. Anything else?
I was just to find out what Peter, if Peter had a comment.
Sorry, Peter, apologies. Would you like to come in?
No. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Colette. This is still really raw for me. Just a few weeks ago, I carried family member's coffin to a graveside and stood over his grave while his 5-year-old daughter said, "But Daddy will climb out of there." And, obviously we all know that he's never going to climb out of there. He wasn't a problematic, everyday drug user. And for my family, it was really hard to understand, you know, especially his brother, who wanted to go and get the person that sold him the drugs and do something bad to him. I know the person that sold him the drugs, and the person that sold him the drugs, is nearly dying as well. You just need to look at that person to see that he's nearly dying, and he's not the person to blame, you know, and the stigmatisation. And, the hurt and the pain, families don't want to stand up and say, we've lost our loved ones to a heroin overdose or, a cheap benzodiazepine overdose. You know, we don't want to say it publicly. But I think now we're starting to see more and more families standing up and saying, you know, we need change. We need things to be different. I love the work of Anyone's Child, you know, where brave family members have come forward and said, you know, that their children or their brothers or sisters or mothers and fathers would still be here today if it wasn't for the outdated way that we are trying to deal with this problem and the issue of, illicit substances. So, sorry, I, as I say, this is it's still very raw for me talking about that experience of losing family members. Things need to change, or we're going to continue to see thousands of people dying every year in Scotland if we don't change the way that we're dealing with this just now.
Thank you, Peter. And obviously, I'm sure we all extend our condolences at the death of your family member. I can only imagine that this is a really difficult time for you, and so we appreciate your contribution. Just aware of time, so I'd like, if I may, to open up what we've been exploring this morning to other witnesses who've been waiting patiently. I'm just going to open it up to ask if any of you would like to comment on some of the issues that have been raised so far. I'll just give you a second to maybe indicate that in the chat. And if there's nothing, I will maybe start off by asking Mr. Liddell, I think you've perhaps indicated.
I have, yeah. Thanks. Thanks for the invitation to contribute today. Yeah, I guess the main thing I wanted to say, first of all, was just through the experience that has been highlighted by Peter, Louise, Natalie and Becky, is the issues around poverty and trauma. And the fact that for most folk, it's actually self-medication. So as Natalie says, the drug use is the symptom of underlying issues. So I think just maybe to go back to the issue of poverty, obviously that are the roots of Scotland's massive drug problem, 60,000 people or so, go back to the 1980s in terms of, you know, significant unemployment, etc. And if you compare, for example, Scotland to other countries with very different drug policies, for example, Sweden and the Netherlands, both of those countries have very much smaller drug problems per head of population than us. And that is because their societies are more equal and more cohesive than ours. So I think that's an important point to make in terms of the origins of the problem. So we have poverty, but then we have, as people have described, issues around trauma that that overlay that over a number of generations, and that's the problems we need to address. I think the second point, I guess, was around the points that have been made around the need for a wide range of holistic services, which I absolutely agree with, including things like, you know, early family support, etc. But I guess what we are facing, and it is a, well, we definitely are facing a public health crisis around the drug-related deaths, and we need to do a lot of things very quickly, particularly around, no one has mentioned so far, the medication-assisted treatment standards that are being introduced, but things like same-day prescribing. One of the challenges we have with the existing services is that people don't stay long enough for the services to help them appropriately. And this then impacts on the wider issue of actually the criminal justice system. So people are dropping out of services, and we've heard a little bit of that. People may then, for a range of reasons, but a lot of the time it can be quite punitive practice in community services that people don't engage appropriately, don't attend for appointments, and therefore they may be removed from a methadone program, etc., and then may commit crime. But we have to see this holistically in terms of the need for community services to be better than they currently are, and then look at how the criminal justice response actually relates to that and helps that public health community response. And I'm guessing, and I'll maybe finish on this point, you know, we have 7,500 people in the prison system. Probably half of that population have an underlying issue around trauma and a drug problem. So we need to keep those folk as much as possible out of the criminal justice system and out of prison. And that's much more cost effective. And the best way to do that is obviously to have much better community services and a range of those community services. Thanks.
Thank you very much, David. Staying on the issue of trauma-informed approaches and care, I'll maybe bring in Superintendent Conway, followed by Mr. Meehan from the Fiscal Service, really just to maybe ask a little bit about how trauma-informed your respective services are. So, Mr. Conway, I'll maybe just open it up to yourself in relation to how that is being built into policing. And then I'll bring in Mr. McGeehan.
Good morning, thank you. So I represent a department with a new division within Police Scotland. It's a merge of the former Safer Communities Department, and we're working very closely with the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit and the public health approaches that they've tested over time, probably the last 15 years, and shown that they work. And we also work with the International Development Unit. So our new division formed on the 1st of April this year, and we are heavily focused on public health approach to policing, trying to embed that across the force. We have people just now working with NHS Education for Scotland and government colleagues, where we are looking at a full trauma-informed package for the whole force. There's already been work done with some of the specialist divisions, but we're actually looking to actually roll that out right across the force. Over and above that, I would just like to pick up just a couple of points that have been raised. The conversation this morning has been really insightful in terms of some of the wider system challenges we have. I think there's huge opportunities just now around about the work of the Drugs Death Task Force. There's a subgroup on that Mr. Richardson will obviously talk about. There's a subgroup on multiple complex needs. And what I see from a policing perspective, looking across the partnerships, there is overlaps, there is gaps, and actually quite a lot of the funding is allocated to the symptoms that have been picked up on this morning: mental health, suicide, drugs, violence, poverty, homelessness, and the coordination of that funding probably could be better. So it's leading to overlaps in activity, gaps in activity, and actually some of the work that's now been taken forward under the stewardship of the Drugs Death Task Force, roundabout multiple complex needs, the use of peer navigators. I think that is a real positive opportunity to try and redesign the system and make it more person and family centred, and help people get to the right service at the right time when they need it.
Thank you very much, Superintendent. Mr McGeehan, can I maybe bring you in?
Certainly, thank you, Convener. I can confirm that as a prosecutor, I personally have received training in relation to a trauma-informed approach. I've received inputs from organisations such as the Violence Reduction Unit, and many of those inputs echoed the powerful testimony that the committee have heard this morning. That's my personal experience, but as an organisation, we are similarly engaged with the Scottish Government work referred to by my Police Scotland colleague, whereby, as a criminal justice system, we're looking to develop a wider trauma-informed training package for all criminal justice practitioners.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to bring in Louise finally, while we're having a look at the issue of trauma-informed approaches and care, and then I would like to move on to another topic, looking at issues around drug supply and links with serious and organised crime. So, Louise, if you'd like to come in and just make as brief a point as you can. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was on the back of what somebody else, I think maybe Pauline, maybe had said, but drugs are worse now than when I was a child, adolescent, because I didn't see half as much drugs when I was younger, or hear about, you know, and I seen it in my family, it was there, but I didn't see the crime or police that were in the streets checking for people breaking into houses and stuff like that as bad as it is now. And another thing, some people that I actually know myself don't go to specific appointments like social work appointments because they don't get on with their workers. Now, for me, that's something that I've personally been through myself. I've not liked my worker, and I've asked to change my worker. Or there isn't any, you have to stick to that worker. If you're not going to like that worker, you're not going to go and tell them your story or tell them what's happened that month, or you know what I mean? If you don't like that person, or you just don't click with that person, how are you meant to then thrive after no speaking to them, basically, do you know?
Thank you, Louise. I think we probably really understand and appreciate that issue, yeah, around relationships is really important. Thank you for this session that's been really, really insightful and informative. And if I may, I'd like to move things on now and look at issues around the supply of drugs and links with serious and organised crime. And I'll bring in Russell Finlay.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank Peter, Becky, Louise and Natalie for your testimony today. It was very moving, and condolences to Peter for your loss. Now, so far, much of the focus has been on what might be described as such street-level drug use and drug dealing. But every single pill, rock, tenner bag comes from organised crime. And organised crime activities are estimated to cost the Scottish economy in the region of £2 billion a year. It's a much-quoted figure, I'm not entirely sure where it comes from. Yet, according to the Crown Office submission to the committee, the value of proceeds of crime confiscation orders relating to drugs last year was in the region of £1 million. It's long been said by many people involved in criminal justice that the Proceeds of Crime Act has failed and is failing. So I'd like to ask Mr McGeehan and Mr Conway whether they agree with that interpretation, and what could be done to to improve targeting those at the high end of organised crime.
Mr. Conway first, was it?
Either or.
Mr. McGeehan, go ahead.
Certainly, in relation to the first proposition from Mr. Finlay that the Proceeds of Crime Act has failed, I don't accept that characterisation. Prosecutors are committed to recovering criminal profits from organised criminals in the event of a conviction. And that is the critical issue in terms of the narrative, the wider narrative, as described by Mr. Finlay. Prosecutors can only proceed to recover criminal profits where a prosecution results in a successful conviction and where there are assets be recovered. And that perhaps explains the apparent discrepancy between the value of the illicit criminal market in Scotland and the sums recovered from criminals upon conviction. The challenge in recovering criminal profits is reflecting the fact that in Scotland it is not only criminal confiscation that is available as a tool to try and recover those profits from organised criminals. We obviously have, in parallel, not dealt with by COPFS, but a civil recovery system as well, that also attempts to address the ill that Mr. Finlay has identified. I don't have those statistics because they're out with the control of COPFS, but the criminal confiscation figures that we have provided should be supplemented and understood, sitting alongside a civil recovery regime that also exists in Scotland.
Do you want to pick up?
Yeah, that's helpful. I was wondering if Mr. Conway would like to answer that in respect to the police perspective on proceeds of crime, whether it is robust enough, whether it could be improved.
Thanks, Mr. Finlay. Proceeds of crime, not my area of expertise. I am a former detective. I was 9 years as a DCI and largely focused on organised crime and enforcement. And we know alone that enforcement doesn't work in isolation. My detective colleagues in Specialist Crime Division are heavily focused on organised criminals. We know through organised crime mapping that drug trafficking remains the largest criminal market in Scotland. It's very lucrative. And it's almost as if as you take someone out and put them into the criminal justice system, they're replaced by someone else. So there's a lot of investment goes into it, but probably not my area of expertise in relation to proceeds of crime. So I'm sorry that I can't give you a detailed response in relation to that.
No problem. Another issue is that, you know, the general direction of travel is to treat Scotland's drugs crisis as a public health issue. But as we know, there are large numbers of serious organised criminals making a lot of money out of the death of people across communities in Scotland and inflicting violence in our streets. In one of the submissions made to the committee by the Crown Office, they list a number of cases where, as I suppose, examples of where there have been successful prosecutions against organised crime. And one that stood out related to an individual who has not been identified, but it's apparent from just Googling who that is. And this individual has high-level links to organised crime, both in Scotland and overseas. The value of the drugs that he was involved in was multi-million pounds and was ultimately sentenced to 8 years imprisonment, which realistically means he could be out after as little as four. Now, this isn't a problem drug user. This isn't a public health issue. This is a high-level organised criminal. I just wonder, again, Mr. McGeehan and Mr. Conway, whether you think the courts are truly understanding what needs to be done in respect of these people who are making so much money from drugs.
Mr. McGeehan, would you want to come in?
I can come in, but my comment is necessarily limited. Sentencing is a matter for the independent judiciary, rather than for myself to comment on as a prosecutor.
Thank you very much. Superintendent Conway?
Aidan, don't have any strong views on the sentencing of the organised criminals, and I'm not familiar with that case.
One final thing, yeah. If that's good. Serious crime prevention orders, which I think came in 2007, according to the submission to the committee, these have been used on 70 occasions for those who've been convicted, and on one occasion for someone who has not been convicted. Now, 13 of these 70 are now in the community and subject of monitoring. Presumably the other 53 will join them in due course. I'd just like to ask Police Scotland whether they believe they have sufficient resources to effectively monitor these people upon their release.
Superintendent Conway, do you want to come in?
Yeah, thank you. My knowledge in this area is limited, and if possible, I would like to feedback a written response in relation to that question, if that's okay.
Sure, in which case it'd be quite interesting to know whether this is a standalone unit that has that remit or whether this is put onto the divisions who have already got a lot of competing pressures and roles to fulfil. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. If that's you finished, I'll maybe move on. I know that Louise and Peter are quite keen to come in, so if I can ask you to be very brief, and then I'd like to move on. So Louise first, then Peter.
The last thing I'd like to say is you want the help to get off the drugs, you'll get it, but nobody can help you until you're ready. That's my last thing I'd like to say.
Thank you, Louise. And Peter?
And thank you for giving me this opportunity.
You're very welcome. Peter?
Yeah, thanks very much. I think, with the utmost respect to Mr. Finlay, the questions that are being asked are the wrong questions. I would certainly look at the UN International Treaty on Drug Trafficking and whether we want to continue to be signed up to the UN International Treaty of Drug Trafficking and how we actually impact the long-term proceeds that are going to criminal gangs at the moment by changing the way that we actually deal with the system. We've tried for 50 years now. In May this year was the 50th anniversary of the Misuse of Drugs Act. Every time you see criminal gang getting sentenced, going to prison, a bust, recovering sometimes hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of heroin or street benzodiazepines, it leads to no impact to the amount of drugs that are available on our streets. We had an international lockdown where restricted travel in and out of the country, both all travel was restricted for a long period of time, and it had absolutely no impact to the drugs that were available on our streets, while at the same time, criminal gangs were continuing to be arrested and caught with substances. So I would say to Mr. Finlay, please have a look. If, as a country, we want to stay part of the UN International Treaty on Drug Trafficking, and whether we actually want to change the regulations on how we deal with drugs and drug trafficking and drug supply, because what we're doing clearly is not working.
Thank you very much, Peter. Thank you for that. I'd now like to just move the discussion on and focus on our next theme, which is policing and prosecution. So looking at issues around decision-making for prosecution, the response to the Drugs Task Force recommendations that were made earlier this year around zero tolerance and other issues. So if I can maybe start off with Rona Mackay and then come on to Jamie. Rona.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Yes, I'd like to ask Superintendent Conway and then about the police referral system and the factors taken into account when deciding what action to take, and then move on to Neil Richardson to discuss a wee bit about the Drugs Task Force. Superintendent Conway, can you give us, I'm not asking for an exact figure, just an approximate level of how many referrals to services are made when you encounter someone who's been using drugs? And I think the next question is probably for Neil Richardson, but also just, you know, what do your officers look for and how do they make that judgment at the time? If you can just tell us a wee bit about that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Don't have a number for you, but in terms of multiple complex needs and dealing with individuals in the community, there's a large number of referrals made to partner agencies, both statutory and third sector. It's done through, predominantly through our vulnerable persons database. I think some of the challenge that we experience from policing is the capacity of partners to respond, and that is a challenge. We know that statutory partners are struggling to meet demand. They quite often, their service provisions targeted towards the most critical end of the spectrum. And I know that there's work ongoing within government looking at the National Care Service and how we can actually make the system better. Our officers are dealing with individuals in need day in, day out, 24/7. We are identifying a large number of people, and we do refer the people into partners. I think the challenge is round about some of the wider system issues where we potentially have people who don't get the right service at the right time when they need it.
So just to clarify, are you saying that when you make the referrals, you're then told that no one's available to take these people? Is that what you mean? Or, I mean, how do you know that they're struggling?
So in the most critical end of the spectrum, I think our statutory partners respond really well. I think some of the wider concerns that in relation to adults and children that go to statutory partners, they need to prioritise their resources. I don't think that demand and capacity meet each other, and that's where often our third sector partners actually fill the gap. So I do think there's probably some wider system issues, that there's opportunities to work in this area to try and improve.
Okay. Thank you. Would you be able to maybe send to the committee the number or approximate number of referrals you do make by letter, you know, if that would be possible?
Would it be specifically in relation to drugs, or would you like kind of overview of multiple complex needs in terms of what we're referring into partners? I'm happy to do either.
Well, drugs primarily. I don't know how easy it is for you to get the other figures, but certainly on the drugs side, it would be interesting to know just how many people were being directed to services, I think. And on the issue of how you make the judgment, is it up to each individual officer about, you know, whether they say that someone should be referred? Are there guidelines for officers for that?
I think our officers, as was picked up earlier in the conversation, our officers are more trauma informed now, and more aware of individual needs. So there is no rigid guidelines for our officers. A lot of it's based on their training and professional judgment.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. Could I ask Neil Richardson, please, just for kind of an update on the Drugs Death Task Force and the pilot schemes that have been going on, and if you could maybe I don't know if you know much about the Medics Against Violence pilot programme in Inverness. If you can tell us a wee bit about that, just to sort of give us a rounded picture of it. Thanks.
Very happy to do that. The key work in relation to criminal justice is obviously wrapped up in the report that was published on the 6th of September around drug law reform. But of course, what led to that was very considerable consultation and discussion with a range of different groups. Also, one of the first pieces of work that we looked at really at the start of the subgroup coming together, it was kind of a detailed systems breakdown of how things work, blow by blow, stage by stage, and trying to identify where the potential rubbing points were and what might actually bring about a difference. And so the pilot scheme, or the Pathfinder scheme that you mentioned, that's in operation up in Inverness, effectively pulls together some of the learnings from that work to try and bring what was just described there in terms of that kind of rubbing between demand and capacity closer together. And it is fairly clear from the kind of evidence that we have is that there's quite a lot of failure demand there. That failure demand where people are either referred but not then dealt with, or not dealt with in a timely fashion, or they're referred somewhere that then isn't appropriate and there's no real remedy for them there. And all of that kind of experience breaks down the trust and the confidence that individuals have in that statutory provision, support, help in the first place. And so when we talk about multiple and complex needs, and when we talk about the real complexities of the system, and what we heard Natalie so eloquently talk about earlier on about the kind of person-centeredness that really isn't all that person-centered, and the lack of care and compassion in the system, that's all true. And that's all my experience of having kind of done that breakdown and worked with partners. And it's not that anybody is trying to be malicious or trying not to be compassionate. It's just the pulling together of an incredibly complex series of organisations that are trying to do their best in difficult circumstances and with limited budgets. So ultimately, what we were trying to do as a task force, and what the pilot that you mentioned is doing, is trying to develop evidence to enable informed decisions to be made moving forward with regard to where we allocate money, resource and energy. And the hope would be that in the same way that we are employing kind of what has been generally described as a navigator approach, that we're doing that with overdose response, and it's demonstrated some really, really positive results. The Medics Against Violence and the Violence Reduction Team have been operating with navigator models for really quite considerable time and have a lot of evidence there to draw on. And so effectively what's taking place in Inverness is a similar kind of utilisation of a navigator concept, where you are providing assertive and persistent outreach support to individuals that need it. And rather than just signposting or giving somebody a card to say phone them or go onto this website, which we know is ineffective, except for a very small number of people, this type of navigator approach is one that is demonstrating a more caring and empathetic, persistent and assertive way to pull together the facilities that are available with people that need it. And what we are doing as a task force, not just in this area, but in all areas, we're trying to develop evidence. It's a really hot area. There are many views, there are many different opinions. But what we're seeking to try and do is hold on to and advise on remedies that are supported by evidence of successful outcomes, and then generate, hopefully, improvement. And that is in three areas: the short term, the medium term and the long term, because nobody expects that we can reform the law quickly. And so some of that navigator activity is really quite exciting because it's making a difference on the ground now.
Thanks very much. That's really, really interesting and helpful. Do you have an end point for this? Is there a time scale that you're working within to produce this evidence?
There are different time scales. The task force obviously is aiming towards a final report this time next year, in fact. So we've got a year to run. But we're also all very aware of the fact that any task force is not the solution. Our job was not to provide the ultimate end game solution. The solution is within the system. Our job is to put a spotlight on things that can be accelerated, done better, to challenge the existing thinking or ways of working and bring about that stimulus for improvement. And so we have a time frame, some of which we hope will be concluded by the time we write our final report, but it might well be in some areas that actually that evidence is still being gathered. Our hope would be, however, though, where there is a sufficiency, we don't wait. If you look at some of the things that have already been discussed this morning, there is compelling international and national evidence to support very positive outcomes, and consumption rooms is a case in point. So the question I guess we would wish to ask is, how much is enough? How much evidence do you require before you can take a decision on some of these issues? And I guess what we would be keen to encourage, given the scale of the challenges that Scotland is facing right now in relation to drug deaths, is that there is possibly a scope to be a little more ambitious in terms of moving quickly.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll hand straight over to Jamie Green, and then I will bring in Colette Stevenson and then Katie Clark. Jamie.
Thank you. And thank everyone so far. I know we haven't got a huge amount of time left. I guess I wanted to broach the point that has been raised a number of times, and that's the legislative framework that operates both within the UK, but specifically in Scotland, given that we have two very separate legal systems. I may start with a question to the Procurator Fiscal's office, the current office. Just looking at the statistics, around 5 years ago, the number of charges for single offence possession has roughly stayed the same. There's a marginal increase from 9,700 to 10,000. But the number of diversions 5 years ago were classified as around 88, which is very low. And there's clearly been a big shift in policy towards diversion. That figure last year was over 1,000. I guess my first question is, given that that increase has been so dramatic, but the year-on-year sad roll call of drug fatalities has also increased year-on-year, is there any correlation we can make between the success of the diversion concept to actually reducing the overall harm and deaths from drugs in Scotland? In other words, has that policy been a success, in your view?
Is that for Mr. McGeehan?
Yes.
Yep. Mr. McGeehan, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Mr. Green. The causes of drug deaths in Scotland are complex, and those causes have been examined, for example, by the Scottish Affairs Committee in 2019. And that complex set of contributing factors has been identified and discussed already during the course of today's session. When it comes to prosecutorial decision making, our focus is trying to do the right thing. And the right thing will mean different approaches for different offences and different accused persons. In 2019, the then Lord Advocate refocused prosecution policy and confirmed that diversion should be considered for all offences where there is an identifiable need that has contributed to that offending. Drug dependency or drug use may be such an identifiable need, and it is that refocusing or re-energising of prosecution policy that has resulted in the increased numbers of diversion that are being offered in relation to simple Section 5(2) offences. What I am satisfied is that in those cases, that was the right outcome. It was the right outcome in the public interest, and it is an approach that the prosecutors will continue to apply and thereby hope to reduce harm and hope to reduce the wider impact of drugs upon Scotland and individuals in Scotland society.
Thank you for that. I guess I'll make it more clear in my questioning. There has been a year-on-year increase in the number of diversions from prosecution, and there are arguments for and against that. That's not the point of my question. But there's also been a year-on-year increase in, sadly, the number of people who are dying from drugs. The number of diversions doubled from 500 to 1,000 in 1 year alone. That's a substantial increase. Is it the case, therefore, that it's just too early to say whether that policy is one that is working from a public health point of view? Or do we have sufficient data to make a correlation between that policy and the health outcomes?
I wouldn't attempt to make that correlation, Mr Green. I would perhaps use more individual examples of success and the impact that diversion can have for individual accused. The committee may want to refer to the 2018 report on the prosecution of young persons prepared by the Inspector of Prosecution. In that report, the Inspectorate used three real-life case examples illustrating the positive impact of diversion for individual accused. And I think those are useful reference points for the type of analysis that you're proposing. And if I can use one illustrative example, because one of those illustrative examples was in relation to possession of drugs, and it perhaps illustrates, again, the trauma-informed approach that police officers and prosecutors are adopting. So one of the examples identified by the Inspector of Prosecution related to a young person who was found in possession of drugs in the vicinity of a school where drugs had been a problem. A police officer who was also a youth engagement officer took time to speak to the school and established that the offender had been seeking help for drug addiction. In the police report, the police officer advised that the offender was remorseful and was being referred to a local addiction team and recommended to the prosecutor that diversion may steer the young person away from offending. The prosecutor took that advice, and the social work completion report after diversion advised that the offender engaged throughout and had started college. At the time of the inspector report, that young offender had not reoffended. And for me, that's an illustration of the positive impact that diversion can have on persons reported by the police to the Property Fiscal Service.
Thank you for that illustration. And I think we all would welcome any positive outcomes from those interventions. I guess of the, is there a role for the Crown Office in terms of analysis of what happens next? Because we very often focus on the discussion around diversion, but not necessarily what we're diverting people to and the success of those programmes. Do we know, for example, of the 500 people that went through a diversion route instead of prosecution in last year, met a successful outcome? Do we know what percentage of them attended rehabilitation or produced an outcome? Do we know how many of them reoffended or are back in the system in that later figure of 1,000 the following year, for example? And what sort of analysis is done by the Crown Office in terms of the ongoing monitoring of those who are diverted from prosecution?
In relation to the individuals who are diverted from prosecution, the Property Fiscal Service receive a report at the completion of the diversion programme from Social Work Scotland on the success or otherwise of the person's engagement with Social Work Scotland and the diversion support services that have been offered. So of those, for example, 1,000 persons who were referred for possible diversion, DOPFS can provide statistics to the committee in relation to the outcome of those diversions for those individual persons.
That's great, thank you. And one final question is a point that I think Peter raised earlier, and that's that not everyone who will be stopped by police with a single charge possession or a first time possession offence would necessarily be classed as those with an addiction. They may be those who have been stopped with recreational drug uses, but may not be suitable for the sort of diversion programmes that some of our other witnesses referred to today. Can I ask what he think, what the prosecution service thinks that the advice to police is in that respect? How do you differentiate, or indeed, how do you decide or analyse whether someone who is stopped and caught with possession is it would benefit more from full treatment, diversion, rehabilitation, or is simply a recreational drug user who is simply breaking the law? Because there may be a very fine line between the two.
As far as the reports that are received by COPFS, Police Scotland have an opportunity to provide information in relation to vulnerabilities of an accused person or the circumstances in which they were found in possession of the drugs or their criminal record or any other relevant factors in relation to the circumstances of the individual accused and the offence. That enables prosecutors to select from a range of disposals, including diversion but not limited to diversion. And so prosecutors in Scotland have a wider range of disposals than other jurisdictions. We're able to select from, for example, a warning, a fine, diversion, a fiscal work order, or in some cases prosecution. And therefore, we have a menu of options from which to select the most appropriate outcome for the individual offence and the individual offender.
Thank you. I wonder if Police Scotland would like to answer the same question.
Can I maybe just move things on and we'll maybe come back
if
we've got time. Thank you. Colette Stevenson and then Katie Clark, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wanted to ask Mr. McGeachan and draw more in terms of what you were talking about prosecution and diversionary. So the structured deferred sentencing, there was a pilot scheme run, I think it was in 2019, within the Hamilton Sheriff Court. Now, I know that it's specifically aimed more at women going through the justice system, as well as like low-level young people who have been offending as well. And you talk about, you know, what you've got at your disposal in terms of sentencing or diversionary. How good has that been used? How effective has it been throughout the courts? And could we do better? Or, you know, just like to know your thoughts on that.
Mr. McGee. So
again, I'm afraid a structured deferred sentence is a sentencing disposal of the courts. It is not a disposal of the prosecution service. That would be a decision for an assessment to be made by the independent judiciary. And therefore, I'm afraid I can't offer any comment in relation to that deferred sentence disposal.
Okay, thank you. Katie Clark, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Again, my question may be one that the witnesses feel they're not best placed to answer, but we've already heard that there's been a significant increase in deferrals from prosecution, and indeed the Lord Advocate, as you probably know, came to Parliament fairly recently to announce a significant policy shift in relation to Class A possession. Is there any evidence that there is the resource being put in place to ensure that we're able to adequately deal with that change in policy? And is there any information about the likely increases that we're going to see in terms of deferral for prosecution as a result of that policy shift, which obviously has been happening over quite a long period of time? I'm going to ask the Crown Office, but it may be that they can give some comments, but may feel that they're not best placed to give the definitive answer.
Thank you. I would differentiate between the announcement made by the Lord Advocate in relation to recorded police warnings and a deferral of a prosecution decision pending the potential provision of support through a diversion programme. But the two are separate. And your question appears to be directed towards the latter element, which is a situation whereby the Procurator Fiscal receives a report, he or she decides that diversion may be an appropriate disposal, and they refer the matter to the local authority, for the local authority to assess, firstly, whether or not the person is suitable for diversion, and secondly, whether or not there is a support programme that they can put in place for that person. Normally, that support programme would be allowed to run, and then Social Work Scotland would report the outcome of that diversion or support programme to the Procurator Fiscal for the Procurator Fiscal to make a final decision on whether or not prosecution should take place. I'm afraid that's a very long explanation for me to arrive at the conclusion you've anticipated, which is that in relation to the service provision or the resources available to local authorities and to deliver those diversion programmes, I'm afraid there's a prosecution service. We are not best placed to comment on that, and local authorities would be best placed to provide a comment on whether or not they have sufficient resources to provide the diversion programmes that they would wish in relation to offenders referred to them.
Thank you very much. If I could put the same question to Police Scotland, and I take on board the points that are being made that local authorities may be better placed, but in Police Scotland's experience, is the resource being put in place, given this is a significant shift in policy?
Thank you. I could probably say a bit about recorded police warnings. I do have some stats here. Obviously, the Lord Advocate's guidelines changed at the end of September, so I don't have anything specific in terms of stats in relation to the Class A change. However, some stats around about the use of recorded police warnings by Police Scotland between October 2020 and September 2021. In total, we issued just under 20,000, so 19,770 were issued, and 5,735 of them were in relation to drugs. So about 29% of the recorded police warnings that we've used across the board in the last year have been in relation to drug offences. So in terms of resourcing, clearly that has a positive impact on the individual because it diverts them. They don't reach the Crown Office. So obviously there's police time saved in not having to do full reports, etc. So there is positives both for the individual and for our organisation in the use of these warnings.
I do have a question about legislation. I'm not sure if it would be appropriate to put it at this point or later.
I'll maybe bring in, I know that Mr. Richardson, you'd like to come in on this, and then I'll hand back to you, Katie Clark. Mr. Richardson?
Thanks very much, Convener. It's just simply to say that, I mean, I think that is a really good question, and it's certainly something from a task force point of view as we work through the implementation of the recommendations. That's a question I'm going to be keen to pursue, just in terms of ensuring that the appropriate resources being allocated and provided to make sure that we can help deliver effective outcomes. And again, I think just what might help is the recent publication from the Auditor General. I think maybe his most recent publication talks about community justice. And there are a number of really significant findings within that report, at least from my perspective. But one which I'm sure the committee will be interested in is the cost. So whilst it may be an open question as to whether there is sufficient resource from a local authority perspective, what can be seen pretty clearly is that there is insufficient alternative resource, i.e. prison space, because we're already seeing a resurgence of pressure on the prisons that needs to be managed. The Auditor General sets out in his report that it costs on average £37,000 to keep somebody in custody for a year. And in contrast, for a community payback order, you're somewhere in the region of £2,000. And the outcome measures that have been indicated, again quoted by the Auditor General, indicate in terms of reconviction as a sole measure that imprisonment has a 49% reconviction outcome, as opposed to 30% for the community-based sanction. So if that is at all indicative of a broader context that may or may not involve the matters that we're discussing this morning, I think that's pretty influential evidence to suggest that there is a better use of public money in community-based kind of remedies rather than reverting to prison.
Okay, thank you. My next question is about the Misuse of Drugs Act. I think the witnesses have made very, very clear that this problem is primarily driven by wider social and economic issues. But clearly the legislative framework is exceptionally important. People have talked about safe consumption rooms, and there's obviously a debate going on about the legality and the legal framework round about that. But could I ask the witnesses, in terms of the Misuse of Drugs Act, what kind of changes are they looking for in terms of the legislative framework? What do they believe can be done within the current legislation? Are they arguing for devolution of drugs policy? And if so, what would that mean in terms of what actual real changes are they looking for? And if I could maybe start off by asking some of the campaigners and ask Peter perhaps if he could outline briefly where he thinks we need to be moving in terms of the legislative framework in relation to drugs.
Yeah, thanks, Katie. Thanks. Well, I think I'll start with a very small quote that I'm sure many people on the committee probably read in the Guardian from Richard Lewis, who is a serving chief constable in Cleveland Police. When the state offers a meaningful alternative to street drugs that can be bought from organised crime groups, the demand for them decreases. So I think in terms of, you know, it's great to see our serving chief constable come out and say that the war on drugs has been a failure and is a failure. You know, the in terms of the framework around safe injection facilities, I don't think that we need any changes to the Misuse of Drugs Act. If we actually look at the framework within the Misuse of Drugs Act, it talks about premises being used for substances like opium to be prepared to be smoked and cannabis to be prepared to be smoked. That's why cannabis clubs have consistently got closed down. When I ran the safe injection facility in Glasgow, there was no police intervention apart from a meaningless allegation of obstruction in the course of a search. So we could go ahead and open these facilities with a simple divert scheme into those facilities. I already know Police Scotland officers were seeing people publicly injecting in alleyways and diverting them to my ambulance to come and inject in a safe, supervised environment without the risk of HIV. I think it's important to remember why safe consumption facilities were first spoken about in Scotland. It wasn't to reduce drug-related deaths. It was because of the HIV outbreak. And obviously, at the moment, we still have that ongoing with the largest outbreak that the UK has seen in the last 30 years. But in terms of the actual framework of the Misuse of Drugs Act, it's a complete failure. I think it needs completely scrapped. I mean, if we look prior to the Misuse of Drugs Act, when essentially it was brought in on the back of the American war on drugs and President Nixon standing up in 71 and saying we need an all-out offensive because the UK do tend to go along the same lines. But prior to the Misuse of Drugs Act, there was a couple of hundred heroin addicts in the whole of the United Kingdom. We knew who they were, and they were all given diamorphine-assisted treatment. Right now, we have diamorphine-assisted treatment for 19 people in Glasgow, which I believe is pushing in around £2 million. Nicola Sturgeon announced earlier this year that we were going to roll that out throughout Scotland, and we still only have the same limited amount of spaces because it's a medically supervised model. We don't have to have these medically supervised models that cost so much to implement and run. There's great examples of diamorphine-assisted treatment in other areas where it is so much cheaper, but we consistently take so little of it that it remains very costly for us to do, especially if we go down the medical model, which is currently still in place. So just to wrap up on that, Katie, the Misuse of Drugs Act, let's completely throw it out the water. Let's get out of the international treaty signed up to the UN, which the UK are still part of, which very few countries have came out of. Let's look to the four pillars model in Switzerland. We often talk about the decriminalisation model in Portugal. We could implement the four pillars model in Switzerland right now in Scotland without any changes to the Misuse of Drugs Act. And Switzerland have been so successful in their implementation of how they deal with drugs that they're now closing safe consumption facilities because there's not the demand for them anymore.
Could I put the same question perhaps to David Liddell and maybe just ask if he agrees with what Peter is saying?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I agree with Peter around the Misuse of Drugs Act. I think the frustration, I guess, in the Scottish UK context has been the focus on the Misuse of Drugs Act rather than Scotland doing things for itself. And that was the evidence we gave to the Scottish Affairs Select Committee, particularly around, for example, recorded warnings, but also, as Peter has alluded to, that with in terms of the drug consumption room he ran, there was no public interest in prosecuting Peter and no prosecution followed. So it's a ridiculous state of affairs that actually he can run a service like that and not be prosecuted, but Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board that want to run a service can't. I think the bigger point, so I think that point, you know, we should proceed with drug consumption rooms in Scotland under the current legislation. And if that requires a letter of comfort from the Lord Advocate, that's what have previously encouraged and pushed for. I think the point around drug consumption rooms is that we shouldn't just have one in Glasgow, though we should have those across the country, and that point has been made alongside a whole range of other interventions, and that's the experience, for example, of British Columbia in terms of drug consumption rooms, but you have those across the country alongside medication-assisted treatment and a whole range of other interventions, and that's what we need to look at. I think the other point, obviously, is around naloxone, and one of the things that we've been working very hard at is peer supply of naloxone, to get naloxone out to everybody and make sure that people carry it. And maybe the final point, the wider point, maybe going back to the, it's not related specifically to this, but I guess it is in terms of the police recorded warnings, is that move in the direction, as Peter has alluded to, in terms of countries like Switzerland and Portugal, of a social inclusion model. And I think that's particularly important for people with a problem with drugs, that they're not caught up within the criminal justice system for possession. The wider point I made earlier is around the fact that actually most people in the prison system with a drug problem are there because of petty theft, that's housebreaking or shoplifting. And we need to do far more to keep those folk out of the criminal justice system as a whole. But overall, yeah, I would agree with Peter's analysis that the problem, though, I think, is that the Misuse of Drugs Act is a UK legislation, and we can bang on forever for the need to reform of the Misuse of Drugs Act. But we need to do things for ourselves in the meantime, for sure, and very, very quickly.
I know we're short of time. If there were other campaigners or those with lived experience that had a different view or a different approach, it would be useful to know. Mm-hmm. But if not, if the Crown Office could be asked whether they believe that safe consumption rooms are possible within the current legislative framework.
I'm happy to do that. I'll maybe just bring in Pauline McNeill. Mm-hmm. I know you've been waiting for a wee bit, and you were quite keen to ask some questions around the prosecution side of things, and you were quite interested in the safe consumption rooms. So we can maybe bring that in as part of that. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, convener. There was more probably wider than that. I mean, I'm struck by how much work is actually going on, really, what I've heard. Morning, we've got a great deal of evidence, lived experience. We've thought about the causes or the what needs to be done. I really wanted to, with that in mind, and I'm clear about the role of diversion, which mostly all the papers talk about, and also I'm clear about the role of consumption rooms. Peter Cowcrant has been running, and we've debated in the Parliament. But I wanted to ask probably Neil Richardson and Peter. I mean, it would be helpful to get some guidance from you as to what you think we as legislators and members should prioritise, because there's so many frameworks and organisations. I'd like to sort of focus a bit on what do you think maybe the top two or three things that we as legislators need to do to, I suppose, build on the work that's been done and tackle this horrendous situation of Scotland having the highest number of drug deaths.
Mr.
Neil, I don't know if you want to go first
Mr.
on
Richardson,
that.
Do you want
to happy to do that. I mean, I suppose it's a really difficult question to answer, because what the report has recommended is that we need to do the analysis that would generate that answer. So I think that the finding is that the Misuse of Drugs Act, it ranges somewhere between now no longer fit for purpose and in need of significant reform. But the extent to which and what the priority should be is the devil that's in the detail. That said, I mean, I think there's a fairly clear emphasis from the evidence that we've gathered to date around the multiple and complex needs nature of all of this that needs to be reflected in whatever legislative change is made. And I think, you know, that's so, so important, particularly when you look around the landscape right now in Scotland and realise that there are some really, post-COVID, there are some significant changes that are being proposed and worked on. And the real risk is that these happen in isolation. So things like a national care service, things like the new strategy for community justice that's being worked on, in fact, consulted on right now, and the work of the Drug Death Task Force that has spent the last couple of years gathering evidence to try and find priority. These things, I'm not sure are as joined up as they need to be, particularly now that criminal justice and elements of the criminal justice world are being proposed, at least, to be incorporated within the National Care Service. And that involves in its own right a fundamental change to accountability and governance arrangements. So all of that is important when we're talking about how this fits in a post-pandemic Scotland. And I suppose the timing of it all is important as well, because what we don't want to do is replace legislation that has largely fallen out of favour because it no longer fits the needs of today with hasty legislation that actually does not properly reflect the needs of tomorrow. So that's part of the reason that the task force has set out a phase two, which is a broader public consultation, which should be a pre.
If I could interrupt you, if you don't mind, this is the problem I'm struggling with, is that I know the work, you have to commend you on the work that the Scottish Drugs Task Force has done. I mean, I didn't know any of it until I read the papers. But I think it needs to be boiled down for us as legislators. There's task force and frameworks and joined up. These are all things that I know as a legislator, it's not, I suppose I need to sort of focus in on, like, boil this down in ordinary terms. What are the two or three things that needs to be actioned on? That's what I'm really driving at.
Well, I mean, I suppose that within the task force report, that there are some examples, whether they are the priorities or not, I'm not sure. Moving towards, as we seem to be, a more public health approach to this challenge, there are particular obstacles that the current legislation inhibit. So consumption rooms, as we've been talking about, that's one. So, you know, the evidence and the appetite is definitely there to support consumption rooms, but the law as it stands doesn't allow that. A more informed way to test drugs that people are using would also mitigate harm, but the legislation is preventing that from happening. Things like pill presses. Pill presses are a real issue because the drugs are changing all the time. Street benzos are the biggest issue that we're battling with right now, and it is really easy to manufacture them because there are no controls or restrictions, or not effective controls or restrictions around pill presses. That would be another easy one. Prescribing, and for very good reason, there are very tight controls on prescribing. But as we move towards informed stabilisation arrangements that involve the third sector and others to provide meaningful help and support for people in addiction, it's more and more challenging if you have got very tight arrangements for the prescribing of drugs. And of course, we're in the middle of a recruitment crisis that just compounds that. So, I mean, these are some examples that they are more developed and more detailed in the report itself, which is freely available on the website. But that hopefully will provide at least a start. But I would come back to I certainly wouldn't want to be recommending that we grab onto a few of these, because the risk is that we end up leading to legislation that perhaps isn't as rounded or sustainable as it needs to be for this really wicked problem.
Thanks. I mean, that is really helpful. Peter, I wanted to also ask you about your opening statement. You talked about how you were not a drug user when you were 16 and in care. And I noticed from the Transport Drug Policy Foundation submission that 13% of people in prison were not drug users before they went to prison. And for me, this is quite a big theme about people find themselves in circumstances where they end up taking drugs because of they're in prison or they're in care or whatever. So, Peter, I wonder if you could answer my question about what else should we be doing here to prevent that, and what do you think the priorities should be for the Parliament in building towards, I suppose, what Neil's talked about, building the priorities to build a wider strategy that's going to make a difference to Scotland's drug deaths?
Yeah, thanks, Pauline. Within the current frameworks, I think it's difficult to take any legislation through the Scottish Parliament In terms of things like safe consumption facilities, it would most likely be challenged by the UK government and the Supreme Court. I think what we need to do, like Professor David Nutt has said on multiple occasions, is go ahead and open these facilities. Once they're open, what are the UK government going to do? Send in the tanks? We simply need a memorandum of understanding to go ahead and do that within the current framework, given that safe injection facilities don't actually break any laws within the Misuse of Drugs Act anyway, apart from the simple possession, which can now be dealt with through the lack of prosecution when it comes to Class A substances. The number one priorities, or the priorities that I would lay out, because I understand those frustrations with task force and papers, I'm not an academic, and multiple papers and multiple task force, and you know, this arm of that task force and that arm of this task force, the things that I would implement if I had the ability to make some changes would be to take what we currently do in terms of all the prescribing services are currently within the hands of the NHS. We have a real risk adversity to prescribing in this country. I have to disagree with Neil in terms of the, you know, pill presses. I mean, that's just another, you know, fallacy that we're ever going to stop illegal or illicit drugs being distributed on our streets. It doesn't matter if pill presses or the legislation around that changes, but we need to give people an alternative to those street drugs in quantities that are enough for them not to have to seek out illicit supply chains. I've already mentioned the medical model of diamorphine-assisted treatment in Glasgow and the extortionate costs of that. We've already got UK-based models which are less than a third of the cost that are being delivered in Glasgow currently. We want to see that as an option to people in Falkirk and Stirling and other places, and also within the prison system. Diamorphine-assisted treatment should be available in the prison system. The written evidence that I submitted on behalf of Cranston has a link to a 15-year study of diamorphine-assisted treatment in the Switzerland prison system. These are things that we could implement without any legislation. I think we need to start taking these actions now, right now, start getting these things done. It's not good enough for the First Minister to stand up in Parliament on the 20th of January and announce a wider rollout of heroin-assisted treatment throughout the country, and for us still coming up to the end of this year only to have a limited amount of spaces in Glasgow because it's so expensive, £2 million per year, with a budget that's already stretched. I mean, I saw an advertisement for a frontline service worker in the Drug Crisis Centre in Glasgow, and the salary was £18,278. Absolutely ridiculous. You know, like, we need minimum wages for people working in these services so we can attract people in and we can keep people working within this environment, because my experiences, the pain, the trauma that you see on a daily basis, that you see every day working in this arena, so difficult to deal with. And if you can't even buy yourself a Cafe Nero's coffee on the way to work because you're getting paid so little money, absolutely ridiculous. Nobody gets into this work for the money, but people need to be getting enough to actually live. So those are some of the priorities that I would address right now.
Can I just come in? Thank you, Peter. We've got quite a lot of witnesses are quite keen to come in on this. We're beginning to cover quite a broad range of issues. Can I maybe just bring in David Liddell, and then followed briefly, if possible, by Becky, and then Superintendent Conway, if I may. So, Mr. Liddell.
Yes, thank you. It was just really to pick up on the point about what we need to do now from Pauline. I know it goes wider than the criminal justice system, but is the implementation of the medication-assisted treatment standards. And to do that, government set the deadline of next April to deliver those. And that's the most important bit. Currently, we have only potentially 35% of the 60,000 people with drug problems in treatment. England, for example, has over 60%. So that's what we should be looking at to get to, and I think part of the issue with that has been that we haven't been able to control the drug problem, if you like. We've seen the shift, as been mentioned by Louise, to an increase in crack cocaine use, particularly among long-term heroin users. So we need to have more people in treatment to contain them, to help them and assist them in services over the long term. And then we need to look at wider issues. So just to maybe pick up on the criminal justice things that we haven't spoken about so far, is people going into prison and the continuity of care. And certainly with regard to through care, we've had various incarnations of through care over many, many years. And we need to look again at that issue in particular. We also have drug treatment and testing orders, which have, in my view, been very effective for a small group of people. And they're targeted people who basically as an alternative to custody. But there's also, in Edinburgh, there's also a DTTO2, which is for other offenders. And we should be looking at expanding those programs as well. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Becky, if I can bring you in as briefly as possible and followed by Superintendent Conway.
Thank you. Dave has just covered a lot of what I was going to say, so I'll be very brief. I just wanted to make sure that people hear the voice of the people that I represent on behalf of the DDTF, which is a range of people who have experience of drug use, prison, all sort of life experiences related to that. And there's definitely a consensus that the support that you require when you have a drug problem isn't catered for when you're in prison. So there are some projects that are doing some really great work, but it's not consistent, it isn't standardised. And if you arrive in prison with a drug problem or even if you don't have a drug problem, but you're feeling frightened and alone and you're in a cell, it isn't very surprising that the people that are going to support you and that you're going to gravitate towards are people who use drugs and have drugs available for you to help ease that pain. So there has to be robust systems that are national that can provide that lived experience within the jail and offer some sense of hope to people that are in prison and that support needs to follow on, as Dave said, once you're released from jail. And very briefly, just to let people know that the MAT standards are implemented within jails as well. And that's something that we maybe need to be really looking at how that's going to happen and make sure that they are going to be utilised within the jail, because those options aren't available at the moment. And we need to make sure that the MAT standards are implemented in exactly the same way for residents of prison as they are on the outside. It's still a work in progress. I saw Natalie shake her head there, but we have to ensure that the MAT standards are implemented within jails as they will be in the community.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Becky. Superintendent Conway, and then I'll bring in Natalie, and briefly if you can.
Thank you. I'll keep it brief. It's just to support a point that Neil Richardson raised in terms of trying to join the dots. There's significant work ongoing at government around about COVID recovery and National Care Service, working on getting it right for everyone. They're interconnected pieces of work that I think there's an opportunity to actually join the dots better. When we look at some of the funding that's been allocated to drugs, to alcohol, to mental health, to suicide, to violence, to poverty, homelessness, jobs for young people, my impression is the joining of the dots and the connection between the funding allocations probably could be stronger. And that would be an opportunity for government to try and connect some of the funding streams, which would then probably give better value for money in many occasions, because a lot of these issues are public health issues. in many occasions, all that funding's been targeted to the same people and the same families, but we actually have to label them or pigeonhole them into a symptom rather than actually trying to tackle the root causes. So that's all I would want to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Natalie, I'll bring you in briefly if possible, and then I will move the discussion on. I'd like to cover the issues around drugs in prisons and naloxone before we round this session off at 12:30. So, Natalie.
Yep, I just wanted to come in just to, I think that we're discussing routes of diversion. And I think for me, it's where do we divert people to? If we're discussing a police level and we're discussing at a fiscal level and all services are saying, you know, there is no methods of diversion, where do we divert people to? Because what's going to happen is our police officers are going to become social workers.
Thank you very much, Natalie. I am conscious of time, so I'm going to move this session on. That's been a very helpful discussion. And as I say, I'd like to move on now to looking at issues around drugs in prisons. I know there's a number of members would like to focus on this. I'll come back to Pauline McNeill. I know that you're interested in picking this up, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you, convener. It was just if anyone had any comments around the 13% of prisoners who enter prison that have not had a previous history. I mean, I find this really worrying, that as well as supporting people who are already on drugs when they go into prison, to find 13%. And I just wondered if anyone wanted to comment as to why is that and what should we be doing about it. Thanks.
I'll maybe bring in Neil Richardson on that.
I'm not really sure I can provide any meaningful commentary on that, I'm afraid.
Okay. Anyone else in particular would like to come in on that? I'm very happy to just bring in anybody that would like to make a comment. Becky?
Happy.
Would you like to come back?
Hi. Yes. I think that it isn't surprising that people who don't have a drug problem go into prison and end up using drugs. It's a frightening, lonely place where there isn't supports for people. As I just said, often the supports that you get in prison are from other prisoners who. Maybe have access to drugs that help to make you feel better in a frightening environment. So I would advocate that we try to support people before they get into prison so that they don't end up in that position. I don't know what the answer is in particular, other than to make sure that there are services provided in prison that look at your mental health, that look at your safety while you're in there, that offer an alternative to using drugs. Thank you.
Thank you, Becky. Thank you very much. Natalie, I think you would like to come in, and David Liddell. So, Natalie first.
I think, Pauline, probably what I've certainly witnessed working in the prisons over the last 6 years is prisons are a hyper-stressed environment. They are at times chaotic, and individuals can very often not find any peace within the walls of prison due to some of the levels of chaos. And I think what we need to remember is there is more time to think and less distractions being in prison, especially during the pandemic when you're locked up some quite often for 23 hours a day. If you are locked up with only your thoughts, and we know that over 80% of men and women going to prison have been previously traumatised, then we're going to look for a coping strategy, and it won't be a positive one. Because again, if we look at the research that's been done, we know that 47% of individuals currently in prison score academically a reading, literacy and numeracy level of under age 11, so they cannot in themselves read or write letters to family members or do in-cell activities. So I think we need to look at the boredom being probably one of the biggest issues around individuals using in prison and an element of peer pressure.
Thank you, Natalie. Mr. Liddell, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I don't really have anything to add to that. I mean, I'm obviously, you know, I talked previously about people self-medicating, and I think there is an issue there around people just using drugs as a coping mechanism, first of all. But you're right, there's a whole range of other measures, issues as well. So I don't have anything more to add to that.
Thank you very much. Polly McNeill?
No, thank you very much, convener. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. I'll hand over to Rona Mackay and then Katie Clark.
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Yes, I'd like to ask Leanne Hughes, please, from Shine. Just picking up on your submission, you say that from April to September this year, 63% of all prison referrals in Shine related to women on remand, usually for low-level offences. Some have serious drug dependency problems and maybe on methadone. And personally, I don't think these women should be anywhere near prison. During sentences, women's tolerance to drugs reduces, but problems arise when they're released if they use drugs in the same way as before, and it can lead to overdoses. And you say this has been a problem with many women overdosing. It's been exacerbated during COVID because of the lack of access to GP services. I wonder, Leanne, if you could just expand a wee bit on that for me, please. Oh, she's not there.
Anybody else?
Anyone else that wants to come in until Leanne returns?
Peter, would you like to come in on that?
It was actually the last point. It was more Pauline's point that I was coming in, but I'm happy to talk about that briefly until somebody else comes on. That it was about the 13% coming into prison without a drug problem. I think people are going to be in prison. That's the simple reality of it. People are entering into the prison system for various different offences which are not related to drug use or problematic substance use, and then actually start problematically using substances in the prison system. It's about how we stop illicit substances getting into the prison system, the same as we do stop illicit substances on our streets. It's about giving people the medication that they need in order to not have to use illicit substances. So, you know, my point goes back to, again, the diamorphine-assisted treatment that's used within the prison system in Switzerland, where people don't show any extra comorbidity issues. You know, they have a work-based system within that prison. People don't have any more time off work, and then people can exit the prison system on their diamorphine-assisted treatment and continue to live really healthy, productive lives when they leave the prison system. So again, how do we address 13% of people coming into the system without any substance issues and starting to take substances is by not having the demand for illicit substances in the prison system, the same as we don't need to have the demand for illicit substances out with the prison system.
Thanks, Peter. Yeah, thank you for that. Shine's submission says it's 63% of all their prison referrals relating to women on remand. So 63% is a high number. Some are seriously addicted at that point. Do you agree with me that prison is not the place for women who have committed low-level offences due to their addiction problem? Peter, if you wonder.
Oh, Peter, would you like to come back on that?
Yeah, I think not just for women, for anybody. I mean, it's not the place for to send somebody for low-level crimes in connection with problematic substance use. You know, there's literally no point in sending somebody to a prison cell, when they need, a social psychological support system in place. And often people do get abstinent within the prison system. Often people who are recycling through the prison system you know, have engaged with things like methadone before, buprenorphine, mutual aid recovery groups, you know, recovery communities, and you know, they're still revolving through the system. So, you know, it's just not applicable to send people to prison. You know, I've seen a story recently where a young man got sent to prison for 23 months for a few cannabis plants. We should be employing that guy. We should be employing him. We shouldn't be sending them to prison. We're already, the UK are already the biggest producers of cannabis. We need to completely think ahead of what we're doing just now and look at even examples coming out of America, where we've previously followed in terms of the Misuse of Drugs Act. We've previously took things on board from America. We now have lots of states in America that have got a regulated cannabis market. We've got Oregon, who have fully decriminalised all drugs. You know, we need to look to the examples that are now becoming prevalent around the world of how we deal with this, rather than our old, outdated system of prison release. On the supervised consumption site in Glasgow, we often dealt with people, we often supported people who were coming right out of prison, often abstinent from drugs, and coming straight back into that system of street level drug use.
Thank you. Thanks, Peter. I think we have Leanne back. And Leanne, I don't know if you heard my question originally, but I'll just brief, I won't go through it all again, but basically in your submission, you refer to women who have, during sentence, their tolerance to drugs reduces, they come out and they very often overdose, and due to lack of access to GPs during COVID, this has been a problem. I just wondered if you could expand on that, please.
I see this countless times. So you've women who are in for varying lengths of time, they get themselves clean, they come back out, they have to wait on appointments for addiction services, trying to get re-registered with a GP is nigh on impossible. So they turn to what they know, what they're used to, and unfortunately that is problematic drug use. And then before you know it, the cycle started again, they're back to re-offending, then they're back in prison. Again, for whatever length of time, they come back out, they've lost their housing, They've lost their benefits, family members aren't speaking to them, so their whole support network also isn't there. It's a huge, huge problem. And sending the females to prison absolutely has, and it serves no purpose at all in most cases.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm conscious of time.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I think Becky would like to come in, and then Neil Richardson. So, Becky, I'll bring you in again briefly, and then Mr. Richardson briefly. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. It was just to go over that point about women in prison, and I think it's well understood that the majority of women who are in prison are in prison because of situations that they have ended up in, often due to abusive partners or just partners who are mixed up in criminality, especially to do with addiction. So really, it was just to agree that it's not the answer to this particular problem, that it just creates more problems and it creates a cycle of addiction, criminality, costs a lot of money because children are often having to be cared for, and there has to be a better way of dealing with the issue of women in the criminal justice system, something that is more supportive in the community, something that provides the help and support that those individuals need in order to manage lives outside prison.
Thank you very much. Mr. Richardson?
Thanks very much. I was just going to, I suppose, support the comments that we made already. But I suppose it, whilst they're absolutely relevant in the for women, they also apply to men. And so the task force took a kind of view around all of this that within the prison context, there were some very specific actions that could be taken forward, and it seems to me that they are eminently deliverable. One is around through care, and it's been mentioned already, and we have experience in Scotland where we ran pilots and we developed the understanding and outcome evidence, whereby you would have third sector people in prisons forming a non-authority figure. Relationships can be started with individuals prior to the release, and the support or the connections can be made to assist them through that release process. So again, that should be and could be reintroduced. The second thing relates to Friday release, and I understand that that's already being acted on, which is really positive. But again, the issue that has been highlighted there in relation to old habits and old contacts, contacting individuals when they're vulnerable on release prior to any kind of support, is a very real one. And so Friday release is not helpful, particularly as you go into a weekend where these services are in the main closed. And the final recommendation that's made there is around alternatives, particularly in that remand space, where you know there's a lot of pressure caused by the remand population, and there are alternatives, meaningful alternatives that could be deployed that would enable more meaningful support for the individuals concerned. So these are already recommendations, and whilst they're absolutely applicable for females, I would just make the point that they're general.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Richardson. I'm going to bring in Katie Clark. I think you'd like to, you've got some questioning, and then I'm going to move on to issues around naloxone use. So, Katie Clark.
Thank you. Just picking up on a couple of the points that have been made. Peter spoke about the production and supply of drugs, and as he knows, you know, drugs at the moment, the sector is completely tied up with organised crime. A lot of the money, you know, ends up in places like Afghanistan. Does he believe that it would be possible to bring the whole of production and supply into a legal framework that wouldn't, you know, still involve organised crime and indeed despotic regimes? Does he actually believe that is possible? Because that seems to be the model that he is advocating. Do you think it's completely possible? I can see how it might be in relation to drugs like cannabis, but for drugs like, say, heroin, is that actually feasible, does he think?
Yes. Thanks for the question, Katie. There's a couple of things that I would reference. Professor Alex Stevens from Kent University does a TED talk. It's about progressive decriminalisation. And then there's a book from Transform Drug Policy Foundation called Stimulants and How to Regulate Them. That would be points of reference that I would point people towards, because it's often looked at as too difficult a question to ask and politically about the regulation of all substances. And when we talk about the regulation of all substances, we're not going to jump from a criminalised market to regulation. It's about progressing towards decriminalisation and then towards regulation. And regulation doesn't mean that you're going to see signs buy your heroin here or buy your cocaine here. It simply means that there's going to be a route for people to get that who have problematic issues with those substances that are regulated and taken away from the criminal gangs. I mean, if we look to the past and we look to the prohibition of alcohol and what we've learned from the regulation of alcohol and also nicotine, tobacco, you know, we can implement those regulation techniques into how we regulate all substances. You know, we're not going to start advertising cocaine on football shots like we did with alcohol 30, 20 years ago, or even just 10 years ago, or tobacco products. You know, we're going to restrict those within a regulated market. But there's so much to think about, because it's not the proceeds of crime in Afghanistan, it's the little farmer in Afghanistan who's supporting his family, and at threat of the organised criminal gangs over there in places like Mexico, you know, the where the organised criminal gangs are threatening the little farmer who's just making a living for himself and his family, and, you know, down to the street level drug dealer who's supporting their own, often supporting their own drug addiction and making enough money to put electric in their electric meters to keep themselves, give themselves enough heat and be able to cook for themselves. So how do we regulate to the point where we don't impact those chains of supplies, and we don't have big multinational conglomerations coming in and taking over the market and turning it into a business, very much like many other things associated with drug dependency. Like, as an example, many residential rehabilitation centres are now a business. You know, they're a money-making organisation rather than what the residential rehabilitation was originally designed to do, to be a point of contact and a social psychological support network for people who want to move towards abstinence-based recovery. You know, so we need to move away from this being a business and make sure it's done correctly. And I hope to see it in my lifetime. I don't think I will, but I hope at least decriminalise, fully decriminalised market with a move towards a progressive and regulated market.
So we're not really talking about something equivalent to fair trade coffee then. So what you're saying, I think, is that you're worried about the small farmers, but surely it's not the small farmers that make the big money out of the drugs industry. It's the drug cartels who are both dripping in money and blood. So, I mean, yeah, these are massive challenges, aren't they? So, you know, obviously...
Of course, Katie.
Yeah.
I understand that. It's organised criminal gangs that are making the money from this, that are dripping in blood, that have got the deaths of people on their hands, you know, and that includes, you know, these small farmers and these small street dealers, you know, like, but we never get the kingpins, we never get them. You know, we get the small-time street dealers and they get locked up for a long period of time and then they come back out to the exact same. This is all, a lot of this conversation is focused on that today. You know, and they're often the people, you know, the small-time street dealers, they're often the people that get targeted as the really bad people, you know, the ones that sell the drugs to somebody that dies, you know, and ultimately it's not, it's the organised criminal gangs. If we really want to take this out of the hands of the organised criminal gangs, look to what the currently serving Chief Constable of Cleveland Police said a couple of days ago in The Guardian. The war on drugs has failed. We really need to give an alternative to the illicit drugs if we are going to impact and dissuade the criminal gangs from... Every single time a criminal gang gets busted and taken out and you see a police report on Twitter about, you know, we've seized £500,000 worth of heroin, another criminal gang's waiting in the background going, yes, it creates a turf war, it creates more death and misery, and another criminal gang gets even stronger. There's never a disruption in the supply chain. I've said it again and I'll finish on this. Mm-hmm. Despite international lockdown and restrictions on travel in and out of the United Kingdom for a long, long period of time through the COVID pandemic, and police still continuing to try and disrupt the supply chain within that, we still didn't impact drugs on the street. There was still as much drugs on the street as there's ever been.
And you make that point very, very powerfully, and these are important issues, and I think thinking through the detail of it, I think, is part of the discussion we need to have in terms of what the alternatives to the current legislative regime might be. The other question I had was to the Drugs Task Force, and to ask, really, given the discussion we've had about prisons and the massive challenge we face, it's probably, you know, the biggest thing that's changed over the last five decades is both the levels of drugs misuse in society, which are connected to crime, but also drugs within prisons and how that impacts on how the Scottish Prison Service are able to manage prisons. Does this Drugs Task Force think or believe that the recommendations made in April 2020 about adequate provision for prisoners after liberation Do they think that those recommendations have now been implemented? So that would be a question for Neil.
If I can just ask Mr. Richardson if you can make your comments fairly brief, because I'd like to just cover off some issues around naloxone before we finish. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. I'm not sure if we've got a task force position on that per se, but I guess from my perspective, and again, beyond being a task force member, I'm also in my day job the chief executive of a third sector organisation that's heavily involved in the space. I would refer to my comments around through care, and I think there is clearly a gap that remains around adequately supporting people before, during and after a term of imprisonment. And I think that that should be eminently resolvable, and we have evidence to draw on what really works and makes a difference there. So I believe that's an area where there's work to be done.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that. If I can move on, and this is I'd like this to be our last area this morning before we finish things. Move on to issues around naloxone. And if I can ask Superintendent Conway just for a couple of comments. The Police Scotland submission on the current test of change for naloxone was very helpful and provided some update. I'm aware that that process has not been concluded yet, but it was certainly helpful to understand a little bit about how that wider programme will support issues, for example, around awareness of stigma and also a greater sort of involvement in change, if you like, within Police Scotland. And one of the comments in the submission relates to public perceptions of the carrying of naloxone by police officers and how that's been generally very positive. So I wonder if I can ask just a wee bit about how important that sort of community consensus or support is, but also ask you a little bit about some concerns that have been raised about police carrying and using naloxone, for example, from the Scottish Police Federation, and bearing in mind that the carrying of naloxone is voluntary.
Okay, thank you. So the programme, we are not the first police organisation in the UK to use naloxone, but we're probably the first organisation to use it on the scale that we're using it on. I know there is some opposing views from colleagues in the Police Federation. My understanding with naloxone is that 14-year-olds and upwards can actually access take-home naloxone. There's significant investment into the training of police officers in the carrying of nasal naloxone, and we've got it in five areas of Scotland just now. I think in the paper it refers to 46 administrations. As of today, we've used it 50 times. So, personal view, potentially 50 lives saved in terms of this. And I don't want to preempt, it's obviously subject to academic evaluation at the moment. We're hopeful of having a report towards the tail end of the year, maybe beginning of next year. And on the back of that, our drug harm reduction team will then look at any learning from the evaluation and make further recommendations to the Chief Constable and the Force Executive about the way forward. Personally, it is really important we police by consent. So public opinion, public confidence in policing is really important. And we are not seeing a lot of negativity coming our way about the police use of this, with the exception of obviously the Police Federation's views on the police carrying it. So personal view, potentially 50 lives saved. We'd like to see the evaluation and like to see what opportunities that then presents in moving this on further. And we're fully supportive of take-home naloxone. We're working really closely with our partners. We're doing a lot of wider training and awareness across the organisation. We are designing cards at the moment that will encourage potential overdose cases, family members to actually use the really successful use of take-home naloxone that's actually, the awareness is spreading across the country. We've been contacted quite frequently by partners and we're signposting them to the right organisations to access the naloxone. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just one final question. You mentioned the report. Do you know if that will be published and available publicly?
I don't. I asked the timeline for this and we don't have a specific timeline, but I will get clarity if that will be a public facing report. I think it will be. We have in the region of 13 other police forces in the UK just now and some international forces that are actually in direct contact with us and they are actively awaiting the outcome of the evaluation. So I will clarify that. I have taken a couple of actions to submit a couple of written submissions. I'll clarify that point and get it into the committee. Thanks.
Thank you very much indeed. That's very helpful. We've run over time. I think we would love to continue this discussion. Grateful thanks to all our witnesses this morning, some very powerful, insightful and very, very helpful testimony and personal accounts. If any of our witnesses have anything outstanding that they would like to share with the committee, please do so. Please follow that up in writing and the committee will take that evidence into account. So grateful thanks to you all. So that brings the public part of our meeting to a close. We meet again on the 3rd of November to continue evidence taking as part of the pre-budget scrutiny process, and we'll hear from Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and then the Scottish Prison Service. And we now move into private session and we'll take around about a 5-minute break. Thank you.